And hopefully it's recording. Okay, now, yep, I got it recording. Awesome.
Reality is we live in a geopolitical world, and there are lines of competition and contest across the globe. And there is a consequence for all those things in the world of cyber.
Geopolitics in the digital age has led to a proliferation of state-sponsored cyber attacks. Let's go over the facts. Nation-state attacks are malicious cyber activity that originates from a particular country to further national interests. These actors are focused and have the means to develop and deploy novel techniques and tactics. Representing some of the most advanced and persistent threat activity, Microsoft tracks. Historically, foreign actors have focused on governments, think tanks, and infrastructure. Today, the enterprise is now the most common target, representing 35% of all attacks. Nation-states might compromise a business to gather high-value intellectual property, or as a way to access their ultimate victim, and the risks to enterprises continue to grow. Microsoft has tracked an upsurge in the sophistication and frequency of nation-state attacks, delivering over 13,000 nation-state notifications to customers in the past 2 years. Nation-state threat actors like NOBELIUM are increasingly targeting supply chains with a 78% increase in attacks on vendors.
Hi, I'm John Lambert. I run the Microsoft Threat Intelligence Center. The Microsoft Threat Intelligence Center has a mission to defend Microsoft and its customers against adversary-based threats. One thing that's different about that class of attacker is they have a durable interest in their victims. They want to be there to stay. And so as a result, they're not just attacks of opportunity. They're professionals. They pride themselves on their tradecraft. They improve it. They constantly have to respond to detection and still be successful in their mission because it's of national importance for them.
But they focus on weaponizing and tooling for a number of different reasons. It could be for intellectual property theft and espionage, to give your country a better foothold in the global economy versus another by stealing research and development, or intelligence-related missions. Hi there, my name's Dave Kennedy. I am a cybersecurity consultant for TrustedSec and Binary Defense, founder and CEO of both companies. Been in the industry for over 21 years, focusing on cybersecurity. It doesn't matter the size of your organization or company. Unfortunately, everybody's a target.
Nation-state actors are hard because they effectively have kind of infinite funding, right? They're above the law, at least in their country. They have very good technical resources. So it's not like they're not going to give up. That's one of the reasons we put in the 80-hour days or 80-hour weeks. Felt like 80-hour days.
Nation states really formed and changed how cyber warfare is being conducted on a day-to-day basis, not just from a country perspective, but also what we see from an organized crime standpoint as well.
The first moment that I heard about it, it was about a particular security partner, FireEye, that was impacted. And that was instantly sort of eye-catching or mind-catching on like, oh, that's a big deal because they're good. Like they're a great security company, and for them to have been hit by this, we know that something deeper is going on, and it sort of just rapidly peeled the onion from there. Rob Lefferts, Corporate Vice President for M365 Security Products and Technologies. There's a couple things about it that make it really significant. The first, it was this moment where we saw a nation state attacker really laying the groundwork on a significant operation over a number of years in a way that we always feared that they would. The issues around supply chain are something that we've been hypothesizing, and to see them really put it into action was, you know, dismaying. And then the other part of it that was significant was just the number of organizations that got hit. It was the span of it. And world-class organizations with great security teams really falling prey to this style of attack.
During a software supply chain attack, an adversary compromises a technology vendor, slips malicious code into a trusted piece of software, and uses their distribution system to spread malware to customers. In the case of the SolarWinds compromise, a malicious code was inserted deep into client organizations' networks through legitimate software updates, bypassing multiple layers of security and providing NOBELIUM with immediate high-level permissions. Ultimately, hacking just one organization can result in thousands of additional victims.
But you know, when you go after a company like SolarWinds, for example, which is a third-party, you know, private company that does work for a number of organizations, you know, with the SolarWinds Orion platform, they had over 35,000 customers that went into it. I mean, to go after and hijack an update mechanism isn't easy. You have to understand the build process, how they push code out, you know, where you can insert your code in, the structure and code of the actual applications itself. You know, you have to be very careful on code quality because you don't want to push updates out that all of a sudden break the functionality and all of a sudden you're busted. So this operation has to go flawlessly.
Oh, when they got a toehold in there, they basically got a route into the most important parts of everybody's computer network. Everybody uses SolarWinds. Well, most people, many people use SolarWinds. So they just got a ticket, a free ticket into all these organizations in a place that nobody would even look twice.
This attacker was sophisticated and stealthy in the sense that they took a lot of effort to silo how their operations looked and presented to a victim to be very different victim to victim.
They were very methodic, and this attack was carefully planned over a year time frame. So nothing was accidental, nothing was left unplanned or was improvising. You know, everything that they were doing was carefully studied, and when they compromised the supply chain company, they first tested the attack for a couple of months. So they, instead of introducing the backdoor right away, they actually introduced just one line of code modification to make sure that this line was not detected.
So when you look at what the attacker was doing, the attacker had to make a lot of choices about the victims they wanted to pursue and how they wanted to go about it. And so what emerges is that it became an attack looking for information to be able to use for its own advantage or potentially for future operations.
This was that spy versus spy game. That's really no different than the same schematics that you've heard about or seen only in movies during the Cold War. This is just the next level. This is just the next iteration of the battle space here.
While we are dealing with a lot of different areas that threaten our security programs, you know, a lot of the fundamentals and basics still can make a big difference in protecting your organization. You know, first and foremost, some of the basics. Vulnerability management, huge. You know, you look at a lot of the breach statistics, and most of the breaches that occur, over 80% of them occur from a CV that's 6 months or older. Keeping up with your patches on your operating system, your workstations, you know, your middleware tier, your web applications, all of those things are really important to ensure that you're maintaining a base level of security, because those are already known issues that, you know, hackers are going to exploit and specific things to that effect. Even basics like around multi-factor authentication. It is one of those basic security principles that you have to have enabled. I can't emphasize multi-factor authentication enough. There's a concept of zero trust, and I want to break down zero trust for a second. It is not a product or a tool, it's a way of thinking. Zero trust is essentially, you know, minimizing your attack surface as much as possible and only giving users in your environment access to what they need. And that goes for servers too. So for example, instead of using full VPNs into your network that now have access to your entire infrastructure, why not just provide them a web portal that they can do all of their services on that they need for their specific job role or functionality? So compartmentalizing data, compartmentalizing how information is accessed, and the roles and responsibilities for users, and that's really gonna make the big difference in these types of attacks. One breach of an individual user should not lead to the entire compromise of an entire organization. And these are all things that we can build very specifically to make things a lot better.
If we are actually going to help them achieve more, if we are actually going to be the people that they trust, not only with the money they have paid us for a product, but put their business in our hands, then we don't just owe it to them to listen, we actually owe it to them to help solve their problem. And solving their problem in the security space is endless. because it is a game of complexity, it is a game of escalating technology, and we can't make promises or guarantees. And so that means that we do have to go above and beyond to connect with them and be with them every step of the way as they're trying to figure out what they want to do. And even when they are in a tough situation and have had a breach or an incident, and we need to make sure that we spend the time with them to help them figure out their next steps.